Big deal for the state of Ohio this weekend. We move about 100 miles from Columbus, where number one met number two, to Nippert Stadium in Cincinnati, where number seven is trying to keep its hopes alive for a national title shot. Let's go to Holly Rowe. Holly?
Well, Mike, many are wondering if Rutgers can sustain that emotion that they had last week against Louisville in that very big win. Coach Schiano gave the team 2 days off after the emotional win and back to practice on Sunday, business as usual. He said they had the best Sunday practice of the entire season. He said that he doesn't think his players will overlook Cincinnati. His only worry was that they practiced too hard this week. Now for Cincinnati, senior linebacker Kevin McCullough said the loss last year at Rutgers, 44-9, was the worst taste he's ever had in his mouth, and it's lasted for a year. He says the Bearcats have everything to play for this season, a winning record and a bowl opportunity. They're putting it all on the line tonight.
All right, thanks, Holly. And McCullough, a real good spokesman for the Cincinnati program. And there's the hottest coach in America, Mark D'Antonio, really building this Cincinnati program, giving him a shot at a bowl this year. Rutgers will get its hands on the ball first. Townsend and Foster are deep for Kevin LaBelle's kick. Townsend behind the wedge.
Rutgers starts with the football. Their impact players, their two running backs, Ray Rice, the tailback, Brian Leonard, the senior fullback. Both of them, we met with them the other night. It was very impressive just the relationship they had. You could tell they had a genuine friendship, a genuine respect and admiration for one another, and they really have played well together in the backfield. Ray Rice, the go-to guy, already over 1,000 yards for the season.
He's number three in the country, averaging better than 148 yards a game. And all those players kept talking about a family atmosphere, and it was more than paying lip service to it. Rice gets the first carry of the ball game, bounces off the first effort to bring him down and gets out to the 33-yard line. Rutgers quarterback Mike Teal proved his value last week. He was terrific in the second half and engineered the game-winning drive against Louisville. He threw the ball very well. They'd been able to catch some of those perfect tosses. It might have been settled earlier. He was terrific.
Well, there you see his record as a starter. He's a winner and a competitor, and I think that's why the team rallies around him.
Rice on the delay and taking down to 31, lost about a half a yard. Cincinnati's defense has been very good against the run this year. They have very active linebackers who have consistently made big plays.
His defense, up until last week, had really done an outstanding job stopping the run. Last week, West Virginia and their spread offense got him for 313 yards, but prior to that game, very stout against the run.
Leonard, number 23, is on a wing. Very dangerous third down player. They love to throw to him. Teal looks that way and throws underneath instead. Incomplete for Dennis Campbell. And Rutgers will go three and out on its first possession.
There's a little pressure right into Teal's face, and that caused him to throw that ball a little bit behind the intended receiver, Campbell. Four-man rush for Cincinnati, able to get enough pressure to force the throw a little bit off, and a good three and out for the Cincinnati defense.
Radigan, who is fifth in the country in punting, is back to kick it away. And Stewart, who's fourth in the Big East in punt returns, will get a shot. And just tripped up as he got to the 26-yard line. Very good special teams coverage, a loss of a yard. Devin McCourty downfield on special teams to make the tackle. And a switch at quarterback tonight for the Cincinnati Bearcats. Nick Davila, a junior college star in Alta Loma, California, in his final year, made a run at the starting job during preseason camp, but beaten out by Dustin Grutza. Grutza suffering from a mild separation of his shoulder and a bruised sternum. So Davila, who played very well in the fourth quarter a week ago, will get the start. He can throw. Fumbles the snap from center. Rutgers says they haven't. No sign from the officials yet.
Well, you mentioned the new starting quarterback, and certainly they took snaps before the game, but a lot of adrenaline, a lot of anxiety on the first play of the game. You got to secure that snap. Ryan Statler, the veteran center.
And Ron Gerald is the guy who will come out of the pile with the football.
The right guard was pulling on that play as well, and it looked like Davila may have pulled out from center a little early. And just not a clean exchange on the first play, and certainly not the way you want to start the ball game for Cincinnati.
Boy, a tough start for Davila. He gets his opportunity to start against an undefeated national power and drops the first snap from center. Teal back to throw under some pressure and dropped at the 5-yard line. That was a catchable ball. Looked like Cordell Young lost his footing and went down just as he tried to snatch it.
Well, Cordell Young came out of the backfield. He had two big catches last week. He's working one-on-one on the outside, and the defender just kind of let him go by him. It's a good throw. He lost his footing at the end of the route, and the first two passes by Teal, you talked about it earlier, two drops already. And to his credit, he has shown a great attitude of not getting frustrated when some of these young receivers have dropped footballs on him.
Well, if he didn't get frustrated last week, he was never going to get frustrated in that big win over Louisville. And now they're going to have to use the timeout. Both teams a little sloppy early. Teal will talk it over with Greg Schiano and the coaching staff. Nothing first quarter. ESPN's College Football Primetime is broadcast in high definition and presented by Pioneer Plasma Displays. Some of the Rutgers fans making the trip here to see if their guys can win again and keep that undefeated season alive. They get a big break here. And the fumbled snap from center and have it at the Cincinnati 31. Teal once again, Leonard open, and he missed him. Leonard had a step, maybe two, and Teal overthrew him.
Brian Leonard is the leading receiver on this Rutgers team. Looks like his hamstring bothered him a little bit on that play. Definitely favoring his left hamstring and coming out of the ball game, but he's coming out of the backfield. Very dangerous receiver. 27 catches on the season. It's just a little wheel route out and up on a linebacker working one-on-one down the sideline on Leo Morgan and ran right by him. And you can see right at the end of that play went right to the left hamstring. And that's something I'm sure Greg Schiano is not going to want to mess around with if it's tweaked at all.
No. He is their leading receiver, one of the all-time rushers, one of the all-time receivers, one of the all-time touchdown makers. He is just a brilliant player for this club. Clark Harris, who is the leading receiver in terms of yardage, makes that catch and appears to have enough for a first down near the 20.
And that was a great effort by Harris because that was a short throw. I mean, and Cincinnati got what they wanted, which was to force the underneath throw and then make the tackle. But watch Harris shed a couple of tacklers. They're in position to make a play short of the first down, but he stiff arms one and runs through the tackle of the other one and gets the first down for Rutgers.
Harris had a streak of 38 games in a row with a catch snap last week when he dropped one against Louisville. Starts another streak tonight. Corcoran, number 19, is the new fullback in front of Rice, who pounds his way down to the 15-yard line. Ray Rice coming into this game had already gained 1,334 yards this year with 7 100-yard games. And what was so interesting about meeting him the other day, Todd, his upper body is so small for a guy who looks like such a powerful running back. But, boy, from the waist down, he's just enormous. No wonder he's that strong.
Yeah, big legs. He does have big shoulders, but he was short. You know, when he walked through the door, you're like, wow, this guy is the fourth quarter running back we hear about.
Rice on the toss.
This Cincinnati defense has got something to it. I mean, they have got some ability to run to the football. Pat Narduzzi, the defensive coordinator. Of course, the head coach, Mark D'Antonio, a defensive guy, was Jim Tressel's defensive coordinator at Ohio State. But the problem is you can't help a team like Rutgers. You can't turn the ball over and give Rutgers the short field. If anything, you need the opposite to happen. You need to shorten the field for your offense. Rutgers is good enough without you helping them.
They're going to tape up Leonard's left leg, as you see. Rice is the single setback here. Here comes the blitz. They great pick timing. It up very well.
Great timing on the blitz by McCullough. He hit that full speed, and because he came in and didn't get off sides, he was able to disrupt the timing of the play. Here's McCullough right here. Now watch him come right into this A-gap and time it up perfectly. He anticipates, and he hits that center right on the move, and that forces the early throw by Teal and the incompletion on third down.
He started his career at Grand Rapids Junior College. He really turned himself into an outstanding player. Jeremy Ito, a week ago, kicked the only game-winning field goal of his entire life. Tonight, he gets a try from 31 to start the game and is wide left.
Wow.
And Cincinnati makes a stand after turning the ball over, and that will fire up the home folks. That's exactly what they needed.
Their offense turned it over on one play. The defense had to come on for a sudden change. They forced the field goal, and Ito pulls it left. And remember, he kicked the 28-yard winner last week, but he missed from 33.
Yes, he did.
And there was an offsides penalty that gave him another shot, but Mark D'Antonio thrilled with that turn of events for his team.
No second chance this time for Ito. Both of these teams knew getting off to a fast start was important. And they'll go with Moore, makes the turn. Moore is averaging 4.4 yards a carry, picks up 11 for a first down. Cincinnati has to run the ball tonight to be successful. They've done it by committee this year. Greg Moore's biggest impact game, he had 119 yards, a career high against Miami.
He's become kind of their workhorse back. They've got three guys that run the football, but he's probably the best blend of inside and outside running, power and speed.
Doug Jones is the blocking back for Moore. And Moore lowers his shoulder and maybe got a yard this time against a very good Rutgers defense. They are number two in the country pass defense this year. The secondary has been terrific behind a blitzing style of aggressive defense.
Yeah, they're strong all the way through. They're very active with their defensive front. Lots of stunts, lots of twists. Their linebackers are fast, and the secondary, very, very good. Probably the best guy back there is their free safety, Courtney Green, the sophomore. Very highly recruited kid out of New Rochelle High School, same high school as running back Ray Rice.
Number four in the country in total defense, number four in the country in scoring defense. Davila underneath and has this one complete to his only senior receiver, Bill Poland, who makes his 15th catch of the year. And it looks like it's going to be a little short.
One of the things the coaches told us about Davila is that he does have a quicker release than Dustin Grootsa. You see, under pressure, able to just kind of flip that out to Poland. Not enough for the first down, but that is way better than a sack. When you play this team, you have to be thinking, get rid of the ball quick. Rutgers leads the nation in sacks per game.
And boy, they come from every angle. Third and a yard, Moore, strength against strength, and Moore's outside for the first down and gets to midfield. That should really raise the confidence for the Cincinnati Bearcats.
Rutgers thinking inside run all the way. Look at all these bodies around the line of scrimmage. The play's going to bounce outside. Nice job by the tight end. Fullback coming around, gets a great block on the seal. The fullback, Marcus Waugh, and that got Moore to the outside for the first down.
Boy, Manny Collins, who was the corner on the near side, really trapped himself inside, ran right out of the play. This time Moore will get maybe a yard. And it's the defensive end, George Johnson, coming in to make the tackle.
So when you play a team like Rutgers and the way they play defense, you've got to realize, you know, because they do so much and because they pressure so much and stunt so much, they're going to make plays. They're going to hit us behind the line of scrimmage some. They're going to stop us for no yardage some. But they're also going to give us some chances to bust a run, and they're going to play a lot of man-to-man coverage. If we can protect our quarterback, we'll have some shots to make plays down the field.
Shiano, of course, a rarity in college football these days. Not only head coach, he's the defensive coordinator. And they'll go to Butler Benton, getting a chance to carry the ball. Foster makes the tackle.
We can pick a lot of different guys on this Rutgers defense, but the two guys I think that make their defense go, the two tackles, Ramel Meekins and Eric Foster, very active, very quick, both under 265 pounds. It was Foster, number 56, who made that play on that last second down run. Very quick move behind the line of scrimmage and made the play. They are undersized guys, but extremely quick.
Todd, if you're 260 and a defensive tackle, you better be so quick and know every technique in the book. Davila.
Here goes the man-to-man
perfect
cover.
Strike. Davila, throw it on the money that Derek scored. He's their speed guy for 25 yards. Now, Davila is a two-time JUCO All-American, and out in California, they've got some junior college teams that can really chuck it around.
Rutgers is going to play man-to-man more than zone. So if you give your quarterback time, there's opportunities down the field. He's the deep threat, does a nice job of getting the defender on his hip, and then the ball is perfectly placed outside.
McCourty in the coverage. Moore is back in there for Cincinnati. And Moore will try to get outside on the sweep. And the Scarlet Knights are all over him at the line of scrimmage. Mark D'Antonio with facing that unbelievable schedule this year. It's rated the most difficult schedule in the country. This is his fifth top 10 opponent. Wins this game, he gets to 500. Took them to a bowl game in 2004. One more win, he's bowl eligible this year. Like nothing better than to get it this week and ruin Rutgers' dreams. Moore. Very conservative call on second and 10. Rankert makes the tackle. Todd, here's their record. They did pretty well against Ohio State in spite of the final score.
Well, they did pretty good against them. They played very well against Virginia Tech. They had a chance to beat Louisville.
Yep.
They did not play as well at West Virginia last week. They couldn't run the ball. They couldn't stop the run. That was kind of a step backwards. Everybody felt involved with the Cincinnati program. That's why tonight's game, such a big opportunity for them to really right their season.
Davila in the shotgun. Short set, can't find anybody, takes off.
Not bad decision. It's a four-man rush. They dropped seven into coverage. He didn't have anywhere to go with the football. Good decision not to force a throw. Run it up the middle and set up a field goal opportunity.
So Davila comes off. The field goal team will come on. Lavelle will try from 32. He's been a little sketchy this year, 9 out of 14. To put Cincinnati on top. And the Bearcats will take the lead on undefeated Rutgers. 11 plays, 65 yards, 5:34 off the clock. The underdogs are ahead.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Remington Titanium Shavers and Guinness Draft Stout. Drink responsibly. Brilliant.
That's Paul Brown Stadium, built in 2000, replaced Riverfront, and it honors Paul Brown, who brought football to this city in 1968 as the founder of the Cincinnati Bengals, the general manager and the head coach. First 2 years in 68 and 69, they played right here in Nippert Stadium while they were waiting for Riverfront Stadium to be built. And Greg Cook, the Cincinnati star, was their quarterback at the time. He was a good one.
He was. Remember that back when they had the block letter Bengals on their helmet, just written Bengals instead of all the Tiger stripes.
Yeah, it was before they got that thing. Kickoff to the 8-yard line. James Townsend on the return, and Townsend takes it to the 25-yard line. Here's Holly Rowe.
Well, guys, Rutgers fullback Brian Leonard has tweaked his left hamstring. He is going to try to go. They took his pants down, heavily wrapped that left thigh. He has been doing a series of stretches, riding the bike, trying to keep it loose. His presence for them is very important, not just from a leadership or emotional standpoint. He's their leading receiver, and his backup, Jack Corcoran, is just a freshman. Only 4 carries, 0 catches, so they need Brian Leonard to stay in the game.
Hamstring's kind of a scary thing, too, Holly. You know, you pull that thing after you've pulled it already. He could be gone for the rest of the season. They can't afford that.
Kind of a cool night, and be interesting to see how he is through the night.
Ray Rice is the single setback. He'll get the carry. Lost his footing and went down just past the line of scrimmage. Picked up maybe a half yard and covered by Anthony Hope, number 12, defensive end, who weighs in at 245 pounds.
I'll tell you somebody who's playing really well tonight so far for Cincinnati, Terrell Byrd, number 95. Watch the push he gets. He's been in the backfield a lot. He forces Rice to cut that back inside. I think Byrd's probably played inspired. His high school team, Cole Rain, won a big game in this stadium last night, advancing in the state tournament, beating Cincinnati St. Xavier.
Leonard is back in there. As Rice goes in motion, they want to screen this. Leonard is so good at the...
They read the screen.
Boy,
well,
did they ever. Middle linebacker Kevin McCullough saw it coming and just blew it up.
Well, he saw it coming, and so did the lineman. The two inside tackles were coming on a little twist, and both of them read it. And they peeled off, but watch McCullough. He's right here. He's going to read it also and make the play. They feel it. They start to drop, and McCullough's right there to hit Leonard right after he catches the football. Right now, this game is playing out exactly the way Cincinnati would hoped it would. Their defense is playing with some enthusiasm. They're flying around. They're taking the game to Rutgers.
Pedro Sosa, the starting left tackle, 6'5", 295-pound junior, is the injured player. And as you can see, they're working on that left knee.
Two-year starter has really kind of anchored the left side of that offensive line.
They were really concerned about that offensive line starting the season with two new guards, but the guards have played very well, and the veterans, including Sosa, have done as well, too. Hey, I want to tell you, you've got our respect. We're not the problem. And I think Rutgers has found a way to get everybody's respect this year. Teal in the shotgun with Leonard beside him. Has pressure in his face and throws incomplete. The Cincinnati defense does his job again.
Well, I think what we talked about at the beginning of the show, I mean, now Rutgers, they're in different waters now. They're a top 10 team. There's a bigger bullseye on their back. A team like Cincinnati says, you know what? We can make our season with a win tonight against Rutgers. That's a different pressure to play under for Greg Schiano and this Rutgers team. Now, the game is still early, but obviously Cincinnati feels very good about their ability to compete with Rutgers right now in this ballgame.
Rutgers, 3 drives, only 1 first down in this game. Radigan. Stewart, very dangerous kick returner, back pedals to the 25.
Drop in the back.
Gets it to the 39 and check on the flag. 48 yards on the return. Well, 48 yard punt, 14 yard return.
These are the kind of mistakes that Cincinnati really can't afford to make. They can't afford to turn it over.
23, 10 yards from the spot of the foul. First down.
Monday night, Tiki Barber, Eli Manning, and the Giants will try to maintain their lead in the NFC East. They have to visit Fred Taylor and the Jacksonville Jaguars. Is it Monday yet? Monday Night Football on ESPN at 8:30 Eastern. Also available in high definition on ESPN HD and in Spanish on ESPN Deportes. Leonard trying to keep that hamstring loose. Mr. Do-Everything for the Rutgers offense. Now Davila will be pushed all the way back to his 20 to take over. Moore on the ground. Runs into a lot of resistance, led by Quintero Frierson, the number two tackler on this ball club.
One thing in watching film on Rutgers that I thought you almost have to do against them a good bit in the game is use a quick snap count, because they try to move and shift and jump so much that you've got to get into it a little bit while they're moving and maybe take a little bit out of the way from them. If you just line up and let them get into what they want to do, they play a lot of mind games with your offensive line and with your quarterback.
Only one wide receiver, everybody else in tight. Pressure coming. They dump it underneath to the fullback, Doug Jones. Jones has also played some tight end. He has excellent hands, as you might guess, from the number 86 number. McCourty made the tackle. They have had the lead on four top 10 opponents this year. They had a real shot at Virginia Tech.
Real shot there and a real shot at Louisville. Actually had a chance to win the game at Louisville on the last play of the game. They had the football and with a throw into the end zone. Off to a great start tonight.
Moore again in that running formation. And if they're going to come out with one wide receiver, that tight end is going to play a big role and possibly a running back coming out of the backfield when they throw the football.
Right. Well, they're a very heavy tight end offense. That's the way they like to play. 90% of the time, they'll have at least one tight end and a lot of two tight end. And then, as you mentioned, with Doug Jones coming out of the backfield at number 86 a lot, they actually play a lot of sets with three tight ends in the ballgame.
Now they go to two wideouts. And dump it underneath again to Jones. And Jones right at that yellow line, which is unofficial, but very accurate. Excuse me, that's Connor Barwin and not Jones. Barwin, a very good receiver as a tight end, had a huge game against West Virginia.
Well, nice job selling the run. Get those linebackers flowing one way. And the fact that Davila is a left-handed quarterback enabled him to flip that out, even though there was pressure coming up the field on it. They ran that bootleg to his left, and it was very easy for him to flip the ball to Barwin there.
He was also on the basketball team last year. You see a lot of tight ends with basketball backgrounds, and it seems to be very, very helpful.
An athletic kid. I guess there's some thought that he might go back out for basketball again this year. He walked on and actually played in 18 straight games on the basketball team.
And Cincinnati has been impressive early, and they even overcame a fumbled snap from center deep in their own territory, which ended up not costing them.
And that says a lot about Nick Davila too, because this is his first start, and the first play of the game he fumbles the snap, and he has come right back and has played very well here in the first quarter.
He's 4 out of 4 for 50 yards. Gladauer is in there as a wide receiver. That pass is incomplete. Collins on defense, intended for Poland. Let's go to Reese Davis. Reese?
All right, Mike, checking in on a prime time pulse. Cal and USC underway on ABC. Trojans just forced a punt, and DeSean Jackson's having to check his dental work after a hit he took from Kevin Ellison. On ESPN2, Virginia Tech and Wake Forest. Wake controlling its destiny in the division in the ACC. They're down early.
All right, Reese, and here come the Cincinnati Bearcats. Gladauer with a carry. He is averaging only 3.3 yards a carry this year. Picked up 13 on this one and caught a crease right in the middle.
Well, watch, the action of this play is starting this way. That's going to force these guys to work this way. And then the play is going to bust out the backside with Gladthar. Watch the linebackers flow front side, and then he cuts it out the backside. Excellent block by Trevor Canfield, the right guard, to spring it.
Gladauer is one of three running backs that Cincinnati has used this year, that running back by committee. Now they'll give the fullback, Doug Jones, a carry. Jones only had 7 carries all year starting this ballgame.
Well, we saw that graphic of the leads that Cincinnati had against ranked opponents. They were up 3-0 last week in Morgantown. But then they finished the half down 21-3. And then watching that tape, they didn't look the same as they look tonight. This team looks like they're very much more sure of themselves and what they're doing offensively and defensively. I think Rutgers in for a much longer ball game than West Virginia was last week.
Second and five. Stewart with that speed sets up on the wing. Here comes a blitz. Pass underthrown, but caught by Stewart. Down to the two, first and goal, 39 yards. That ball hung in the air, and Stewart was the guy who came down with it.
Well, you think, okay, if you're throwing this, don't throw it inside. Keep the ball outside. Well, he throws it inside where the safety can come help, but the safety took a bad angle. Ron Garal took a bad angle to the football. And Stewart was able to come down with the catch. And that's a case sometimes where the wide receiver just has a better opportunity to make a play on the football than a defensive back.
The safety ran right by it. That's the end of the first quarter, and Cincinnati has the lead. Cincinnati, where the Bearcats are trying to stun undefeated and seventh-ranked Rutgers. So far, they're doing a pretty good job. Up 3-0, first and goal from the two.
And this is where Davila needs to really make sure that snap again, down by the goal line.
Gladauer to the one.
I'm going to go back to the big catch by Stewart and show you a couple things. The first thing to watch is watch the protection up here. And then watch the safety for Rutgers is going to take a bad angle. Ron Geralt is going to be in position to make a play. Now right here, instead of going this way to help, he comes at this angle and he runs right past the football. And Stewart was able to make the catch right behind him. Just a poor angle by a good football player.
Second and goal. Jones, the fullback, Gladauer, the tailback. Davila, he can run for it, there's room. Touchdown! And Rutgers just looks stunned. Oh, a nice move by Davila.
I've been impressed with the pass protection by the Cincinnati offensive line, giving Davila plenty of time to look over the field.
Lavelle for the point after.
Go back and take a look at the touchdown. Davila is actually looking for a couple of crossing routes. He's looking for the tight end and he's looking for the flanker. But nothing's going to open up. But because the protection is pretty good in there and there's no immediate pressure, he's able to flush out on his own and then he's got open territory to the left corner. Good job by that offensive line giving him initial time and then the ability to run for the touchdown.
You mentioned it at the beginning of the game. They've got the target on their back now. It's the first time ever Rutgers has played as a top 10 team. There is a difference between being the hunter and the hundred.
Right.
It's it's a different mindset.
Yeah.
And right now, Cincinnati is the hunter, and they're eating up Rutgers.
That's right. And it's a different mindset for the team you're playing, because right now they're looking at it and say, hey, you know what? We can make our season. If we beat Rutgers, we can turn this whole thing around.
Yeah.
And the other thing we haven't mentioned yet about Cincinnati, they're trying to get bowl eligible. So they got a double-edged thing tonight. They could beat a top-ranked team, and they could make themselves bowl eligible all at the same time. And they're off to a great start in doing that.
Davila, since he fumbled that first snap from center, 5 out of 6, 88 yards. He's run the ball twice, one for a touchdown. Pretty decent first half for that young man. Foster. Yikes. Got to the 17. Let's check in with Reese. He has a Sports Center, 30 and 30.
All right, Mike. The epic clash, biggest game in college football this year. Jim Tressel and the Buckeyes defeating Michigan 42-39. Buckeyes on their way to the national championship game. Troy Smith probably sealed up the Heisman, 300-plus yards and four touchdowns. Byron Leftwich going to undergo surgery on his foot. Status for the rest of the season is unknown for the Jaguar quarterback. SportsCenter after the game, ESPN News always.
All right, Reese, and for you Rutgers fans and people who maybe haven't followed the Scarlet Knights very closely this year, they were behind last week against Louisville and made a tremendous comeback. But right now, they're going to have to find a way to do something against Cincinnati's defense. And that's a good place to start with Ray Rice. He's up to the 24 before Dominic Ross, the strong safety, made the tackle. And there is so much on the line for Rutgers. They have to run the table, or they have no shot at a national championship. They're not going to succeed as a one-loss team. It's the first time they have ever played in the top 10. They were undefeated once before in 1976, but so lightly regarded, they were 15th in the final poll at 11-0. Teal draw play, Ray Rice.
There you saw that leg strength of Ray Rice. I mean, he was met in the hole. And his ability to keep those legs rolling, moving and breaking tackles, arm tackles, a very difficult guy to arm tackle because he's got a low center of gravity and very powerful legs. Right there at the point of attack, that's a defensive tackle that had a shot at him. Not able to bring him down.
That was Hopple, and Nakamura, the safety, had to make the stop. You go low, you're running into tree trunks on this kick. Leonard is back in there at fullback with a sore hammy and everything. Teal with time. That should be a flag, and it is.
Well, that was a well-thrown ball by Teal, too. Definitely looked like it was a catchable pass and would have been a catch. And just a reaction and instinct by Mike Mickens to just reach out and grab.
Mickens on Tim Brown.
On the defense. The only 21, 15 yards line of scrimmage, first down.
The only positive, if you want to find a positive, is this is better than letting him catch it and run for a touchdown. Because it's 15 yards in college football. It's not a penalty at the spot of the foul like this would be in pro football. So you give him 15 yards, but anytime you reach out and grab like that, you're going to get flagged for it.
He did a great job on Ted Ginn Jr. when they played Ohio State. He was a second-team All-Big East performer as a freshman.
I know Leonard is in there, but he doesn't look like he's running full speed to me. I mean, I think they want his presence out there, and he said he could go. He doesn't look 100% to me.
Cincinnati may have jumped Rice. Gets down to the 45-yard line. And apparently one of the Bearcats got back in time.
This is where you find out more and more about your team's character. I was so impressed with the kids that we talked to yesterday.
Yeah.
Ray Rice and Brian Leonard and Ramel Meekins from the defensive side of the football. Just guys, they appreciate that family. A lot of the older guys have been there when they were 1-10 and 2-9. They know what that side of it feels like. Great senior leadership, and that's when you need the senior leadership, is in a situation like this where you're down on the road.
They seem so well grounded. Teal with plenty of time and throws complete down to the 40-yard line to Kenny Britt. Number 88 making only his fifth catch of the year.
Kenny Britt, I think, is a guy that is going to be a big-time player here for Rutgers. He's a tall receiver, 6'4", 205-pound freshman out of Bayonne, New Jersey. Originally had committed to Illinois, and on the night before signing day, changed his mind and stayed at home in the state of New Jersey and came to Rutgers, and he's a big-time talent.
And that's been the key to Greg Schiano's success, being able to keep some of the star high school players in the state of New Jersey. Leonard is the single setback on third and two. quick throw, little flanker screen out to Townsend, and Townsend has a first down inside the 30.
Great job of blocking by the two wideouts out there, Underwood and the guy we just got done talking about, Kenny Britt. It's a wide receiver screen. You're throwing it to the third guy out there. You got to get the other two guys blocking. 88 and 7, both get on their men, and that allows the receiver to go straight up the field for the easy first down.
Well designed, well executed. Leonard goes to a wing. Rice is the tailback. They like that little toss better than the handoff, and Rice powers his way to the 25. That always looks like a dangerous play to me.
Well, it looks like it gets right up on the back so quickly.
Yeah.
But it's obviously something that they rep over and over again in practice. Should also mention for Rutgers fans, it's good to see Pedro Sosa back in the ballgame at left tackle. He was down on the field a couple series ago, back in there. Seems to be okay.
He's 77. And Ray Rice has become the single-season record holder for rushing yards. 1373 now and counting. Adding to it here. Spins down to the 21-yard line. Let's go to Holly Rowe. Holly, what do you have?
Well, guys, Ray Rice just broke a record that for Rutgers has stood for 33 years. J.J. Jennings set that record back in the 70s. And instead of thinking, oh, I don't want him to break it, he was in the paper this week saying, hey, every time he runs the ball, I love it. I love how this guy runs. He's already got his tickets for next week's game versus Syracuse. But, guys, he doesn't have tickets for West Virginia. So anybody out there, give J.J. Jennings a break.
Holly, that might be a tough ticket. Rutgers wins this game, wins next week. It could set up a game for just about everything in the Big East and maybe in the national championship picture, too.
Uh-oh.
Teal intercepted by D'Angelo Smith, and he's got company down the sideline. D'Angelo Smith will go 83 yards for a touchdown. Adam Hoppe was in Teal's face. Teal was trying to make a play, and instead he made a mistake. Turnaround in Cincinnati.
Wow. We talked about Terrell Byrd, the other defensive tackle, having a great first half. That was his partner in there, Adam Hoppe, with the pressure that forced the throw behind the receiver. Rule of thumb, when you throw it out, you better throw it out. You throw it out in, bad things happen.
I think the shorthand is out in pick six. 17-0 Cincinnati. They're dancing in the streets in Louisville. D'Angelo Smith may have never experienced something that much fun in his life. 84-yard officially interception return for his first collegiate touchdown. Foster and Brown are deep to receive. Foster from the five. And Rutgers will really have its mental attitude tested right now.
Let's go back to the touchdown. It starts with these two defensive tackles. Watch Terrell Byrd come in here and draw the blocks, and then Hoppe's going to step in and then work back outside. And his pressure on the quarterback, Teal, forces the bad throw right in his face, forces the throw behind the receiver, and that's an easy interception for D'Angelo Smith. These two sophomore defensive tackles have played very well against the Rutgers offensive line so far.
If you're Greg Schiano, what do you tell your team?
Keep chopping. I mean, that's all you can tell them. Keep chopping. All right, we can't turn the ball over. We got to just make some plays now.
And they go back to what they do best, and that's run the football with Rice, but he only gets a couple.
We just showed you that graphic a few series ago. They were down 25-7. to Louisville. Now, the difference was that game was at home, and once they got it rolling, they got that home crowd behind them in a big way, and that was huge in that game last week. But 17 to nothing, obviously they have experience in their memory bank that's not an insurmountable lead, but they've got to protect the football, and they've got to get some things going offensively right now. But again, I don't know that Brian Leonard is at full strength, and that limits them in what they can do offensively.
Teal to the shotgun. He'll hand it off to Rice out of that formation to the 30. Let's check in with Reese.
All right, Mike, putting our fingers on the primetime pulse. Cal and USC had a wild exchange. USC had a touchdown wiped off the board for a penalty. Then Cal returned a fumble for a touchdown that was wiped off on review for an incomplete pass. The end result, Trojans kicked a field goal. They're up 3-0 late in the first. Virginia Tech and Wake Forest on ESPN2. Hokies leading by 4, third quarter's not far away.
All right, Reese, thanks very much. And the drama continues here. Another big third down for Rutgers. They have done nothing against Cincinnati's defense. Three-man rush. They drop 8 in coverage. And Teal throws incomplete right through Townsend's hands and nearly intercepted by Mickens.
Well, another ball that is probably, you'd have to say, is a catchable ball for Townsend. A little high. He had to throw it over a linebacker's hands. But that's a ball that Rutgers, if they want to get back in this game, if they want to win a big game on the road, they've got to make those plays.
You don't contend for national championship dropping passes like that. Radigan to kick to Stewart. Beautiful kick this time. Stewart late fair man. Catch signal.
Did he try to touch the ball?
He may have.
Oh.
And Rutgers has it.
Yeah, just a real error in judgment by Antoine Horton. And I don't know if he thought the ball hit him because he ran into the returner. By accident, he ran into D'Angelo Smith, and I think maybe he thought he had to go back and recover the football.
I think he just reacted.
Yeah, he ran into the intended receiver, Derek Stewart, on the punt. And I don't know if he knew whether Stewart hit the ball or not. But at that point, it's not a live ball. As soon as it hit Horton, it became live.
This could be the break that Rutgers had to have. They take over at the 25. Can they take advantage? Rice, only a couple. That Cincinnati defense has been tough. Corey Smith, the linebacker, led the charge on that one.
Well, we mentioned this last week. West Virginia ran for 313 yards and 5 touchdowns. But prior to that, the 5 previous opponents that played against Cincinnati averaged only 66 yards a game rushing. So they've played good run defense this season.
I think when you play West Virginia, you can sort of throw that stat away because they get 313 on everybody. And Cincinnati doing a great job on a second down play that takes the ball only to the 20-yard line. It's going to be third and 5. They're just not giving anything up.
And right now, what you can feel is that what this game is going to have to be for Rutgers. This is going to have to be about a 40-carry game for Ray Rice. And Brian Teal is going to have to win the game with big throws. I mean, Cincinnati is playing pretty well against the run. Rice already with 14 carries. He's probably going to get 40 tonight.
Well, somebody's going to have to catch Teal's passes again. Leonard goes out as a flanker to the top of your screen this time. Looking the other way, the pass underneath complete, but it's going to be a couple of yards shy of a first down as Kevin McCullough is right there on Kenny Britt. Now, what do? You send on the field goal team.
Remember, Ito missed his first attempt to put points on the board for Rutgers. Needs to knock this one through. They got the momentum, the break on the muffed punt. Got to capitalize here. But a good stop by the Cincinnati defense on the short field.
This will be 34. He was wide left from 31. Clark Harris, the snapper. Anthony Calley is the holder. And Rutgers gets on the scoreboard. They take advantage of the turnover on the punt that was touched, and they get on the scoreboard for the first time here in the second quarter.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by the Honda Ridgeline, Motor Trend's 2006 Truck of the Year, and Phillips. Simplicity is Phillips.
Here's tonight's Aflac trivia question. Till Rutgers this week, which team took the longest to obtain their first ever AP Top 10 ranking? We have the ESPN College Football Encyclopedia. You just sneak a look at page 1420 or be fair about it.
That's not really a hint.
No, that's the answer.
Yeah. If you want to find the answer, look it up in the book.
Well, that was a victory for Cincinnati. They held beautifully. And they'll start from the 20th. This kick goes into the end zone. Let's take you back to last week, November 9th, and the Rutgers defense held Louisville to 266 yards, which is 227 below their average coming into the game of almost 500. Ray Rice rushed for 131 yards, had two touchdowns, and then Jeremy Ito's 28-yard field goal with only 13 seconds left gave Rutgers the win 28-25. But they do not look that sharp yet tonight.
No.
Far from it. Waugh and Benton, the new running back combination for Cincinnati. Benton, the deep man in the eye. And he'll get the carry.
Right now, Rutgers
picks up a couple.
And right now, Rutgers really bringing extra bodies around the line of scrimmage. That time, nine guys in around the ball, anticipating the run. I think Cincinnati, the guy they've got to get involved in the game right now is their tight end, Brent Celek. He's their top receivers, have excellent hands running routes on the inside. Little play action or quick throws to the tight end on the inside on early run downs.
He's the best receiving tight end in the Big East, holds all the school records from that tight end spot. Davila, a little bootleg. Boy, he's played well tonight. Throws this one
and he has
behind his intended receiver. Had him wide open. That was Ernest Jackson.
He had him and he had Celek. Celek was the short receiver and he had him right in front of him. And he opted to try for the deeper throw down the field. Again, I think this is a guy you got to get involved in the game because he's been an integral part of what offensive success you've had this season.
Really the first poor throw of the night for Davila. Who got everybody's attention last week with 10 out of 17 in the fourth quarter against West Virginia, two touchdowns. They go to the shotgun here. And then they run the draw play to no avail, only a couple of yards for Benton. Well, let's go to Holly.
Well, guys, I've been over here on the Rutgers sideline trying to gauge the mood, and ironically, I don't sense a lot of panic. Just before this defense took the field for this series, their great defensive end, Jamal Westerman, got the guys together and said, guys, we love this. This is the kind of thing we like. Let's go out there and get after them. I guess they're so comfortable being the underdogs, guys. They're not used to this top 10 stuff. Maybe they're trying to get back to that comfortable world being underdog tonight, down two scores.
Well, Holly, they've made it. I mean, you're the underdog if you're down 17-3 with time running out in the half. That was the first three and out for their defense tonight. And now Foster waits back at his 37 for a chance to make something happen. And Foster dives ahead to the 45-yard line, 6-yard return. But there's a flag down. Naturally, it's a punt. Why wouldn't there be a flag down?
During the return, block in the back. Number 24 on the receiving team, 10 yards, first down.
Joe Porter, a backup corner, called for a block in the back. And that will move Rutgers back. Here's the answer to tonight's Aflac trivia question. The question was, until Rutgers this week, which team took the longest to obtain the first AP top 10 ranking. And I bet you didn't get it unless you were an Iowa State fan, because they did it in 02. You could have gotten it if you cheated and looked up the answer in the ESPN Football Encyclopedia.
I didn't get it.
No, I didn't either.
Teal unloads. Britt, that could be interference as Mickens was all over him, and there come the flags.
Well, that's the second time that Mickens has been flagged tonight. We talked to the Cincinnati coaches. Patrick Narduzzi said about Mickens that he's got great technique. He's a great competitor. Started last year as a freshman, but
pass interference on the defense. Number 21, 15 yards from the line of scrimmage. Automatic first down.
Well, we know he's smart. When he's beat, he just reaches out and grabs the guy.
Well, yeah, but that's not a great instinct, because you're always going to get called for that.
Teal has picked up 30 yards in pass interference calls tonight. He has 29 yards passing. So that hidden yardage has been huge so far for Rutgers in the passing game. Teal again throws out to Leonard in the flat, breaks a tackle, and goes out of bounds just shy of the 45-yard line. Let's go to Reese.
All right, guys, USC and California Trojans had just picked off Nate Longshore, but Brandon Mebane stops Chauncey Washington in the end zone. Safety there. USC's average starting field position has been its own six. It's 3-2 starting the second quarter, or bottom of the fourth.
I like the bottom of the fourth. No action in either bullpen. Action here for Rutgers, trying to make something happen after they fall behind 17-0. Blitz coming. They pick it up, and Rice will get down to the 44.
Well, that was a nice play by Mickens. He's gotten a couple pass interference calls. This time he comes hard from his corner position and makes the play on Rice. This was an inside linebacker blitz, and Mickens was able to come flying up there and make a nice play.
Another big third down. Game clock under 3 minutes. Only 2 out of 8 for Rutgers on third down in this ballgame. Leonard in the backfield with quarterback Mike Teal. Teal looking toward Leonard, but he's covered. Then he throws it away. They wanted a screen out there, and now penalty markers are down.
Probably going to be linemen downfield because the ball was thrown beyond the line of scrimmage. That's the second time Rutgers has tried to throw a screen, and both times Cincinnati has been waiting for it and sniffed it out before it developed.
Ineligible downfield on the offense. Number 63. Penalty decline. Fourth down.
As a quarterback, you're caught between a rock and a hard place there. You've got to throw the ball to the line of scrimmage to avoid an intentional grounding.
You're right.
And, you know, you're going to get one called on you. So they'll have to kick it away. And Rutgers unable to take advantage of another break. Kick. Fair catch made just outside the 11-yard line. Will Rutgers play in the BCS championship game? When we come back, we'll talk about how that might happen. Back at Cincinnati, Jones carries for a couple of yards. Takes it out to the 15-yard line. And the Bearcats of Cincinnati would be very happy to let this clock run out and take us down to the end of the first half. And now we've got another timeout with 1:42 to go on the first half clock.
I think we have a timeout. I think we have some.
Well, we got something. Yeah. I guess they're not playing.
We got some red hat issues, is what we have. Right
I think
here.
So.
Right now for Cincinnati, something that's very important is, I mean, obviously they want to go into the locker room with this lead, 17-3. So Nick Davila, the rest of the Cincinnati ball carriers, receivers have to be very smart with the football right now. They need to protect the ball and not do anything foolish here to give Rutgers a chance to get a score right before halftime. Keep the pressure on Rutgers down two touchdowns to take into the locker room. Don't give them any chance to change momentum here right before the end of the half.
Now, if they're saying there was no timeout called
the clock
should still be running. And now they'll start. Mark D'Antonio was upset that the clock stopped at all. Although I don't think it will affect the timing by the time it's over.
Well, Rutgers may use their timeouts to try to force a punt and at least go after the punter or try to send a return.
They have two left. But they're certainly letting a lot of time slip away here.
Well, they may use one if they get a stop here on third down and save one for their offense.
Well, the offense you would think could do better with 25 seconds and no timeouts than one timeout and have the clock run all the way down. And it would be a moot point because Cincinnati gets a first down out of it.
Cincinnati has matched the intensity and the physical nature and the enthusiasm of Rutgers in this first half. That'll be the big challenge for Greg Schiano in the locker room to tell these guys, hey, look, this team has come to play tonight. And if we don't match their intensity and if we don't kick it up a notch or two, all this stuff that we've had going good for us and that we've worked for is going to get shot down pretty quickly in the next 30 minutes. There's a fumble. So that's the thing you can't have happen here at the end of the half.
This would be unbelievable, and Rutgers has the football. With 12 seconds to go in the half, and you have to ask yourself, how is that possible?
You know, you ask how is it possible, but it happens so many times where teams that are a little bit of a notch below, maybe not expected to win. They play great in the first half and right in. That was just never a clean exchange between the quarterback and fullback. It hit him up around the chest instead of in the belly. And you just see it happen so often where you give a team a chance to get themselves right back in it from a momentum standpoint right before the half.
Rutgers gets the fumble, then uses a timeout because of the new timing rules. The clock would have started on the change of possession. They only had 12 seconds anyway, so they make good use of that timeout. They have one left.
Cincinnati just called timeout, and kind of like the old basketball situation, you see what they look like coming out of a timeout for an out-of-bounds play, then you call a timeout.
Well, of course, this is not just an end-of-the-season game that doesn't mean a whole lot. It, of course, means bowl eligibility for Cincinnati. For Rutgers, it means a whole lot more. They still have a shot at a national championship, and they can get to it in this way. They have to win the rest of their ball game. Rutgers would have to leapfrog Michigan, and I think that's possible after the result today. USC loses to California, that's possible. Notre Dame loses to USC, that's possible. Florida and Arkansas both lose the second game. Certainly that's possible because Arkansas has to play LSU, and then they'll meet each other in the SEC title game.
Yeah, but that first one is the primary goal
now,
and that is to win out.
It's the only one they control.
That's exactly right. And all that other stuff is possible. But it's also possible for that number one to go away quickly.
Yep.
You know, because you've got, again, you've got a bigger bullseye on your back. Cincinnati is showing an inspired play tonight after a lackluster performance in Morgantown last week. And Syracuse will play the same way against them next week if they come into that game undefeated.
Well, can they do it here? They get a huge break. The other break they got, they only converted into a field goal. Blitz coming. Teal toward the end zone.
Great play.
Mickens. Intercepted by Mickens. Holy cow.
You know what? You say that a defensive cornerback has to have short-term memory loss more than any other position. He's the same guy that's gotten the two interference calls on him. He keeps competing. He stays in there, and he makes a big-time interception right before the half. Pat Narduzzi said he challenged him. I mean, he's a guy that you can challenge to be more competitive. And he said, I got something for you Saturday night, coach. He had something right there to end the half for Cincinnati.
Not a good throw by Teal. Yeah. But Underwood looked like he never found the ball until he was deep in the end zone and couldn't compete for it.
Well, when you throw that fade or that out-go route, you want to keep it outside, to over the outside shoulder of the receiver. You don't throw it inside where the defender is playing a receiver. That ball was thrown too far inside by Teal.
Think Cincinnati might take a knee this time instead of handing it off?
I think they will take a knee this time.
And when they mark it ready for play, they may not even have to make that decision.
Yeah, that's true, too.
Maybe. Which is the question up here on that last possession. Why did you bother to even hand it off when you could have taken a knee? What a first half for Cincinnati. They lead number seven undefeated Rutgers 17-3. And if you're honest about it, it hasn't been that close.
No.
Let's go to Holly Rowe.
Coach Shano, what did you think about your team's intensity in the first half?
I think we're playing with intensity. We're not making plays. We're doing some things that, you know, you're not going to win games when you turn the ball over. But
what kind of things?
Well, we're turning the ball over. We're not being very smart, and we're not getting things done. But you know what? This group of kids, they'll fight back. We'll be all right.
All right. Thanks, Coach.
Thank you.
The halftime score here in Cincinnati, the Bearcats 17, Rutgers 3. Let's join Reese Davis in the studio. He has the Pontiac Performance halftime report. Welcome back to Cincinnati. Time now for the Remington first half stats, and it's Cincinnati with 163 total yards to only 85 for Rutgers. Cincinnati has done a tremendous job in bidding for an upset. You ever have one of those great dreams and then all at once you step off a cliff? Rutgers had that dream in the first half. In fact, they've stepped off a cliff several times.
Yeah, but they can get right back up on that ledge. I mean, they've just got to do some things a little better in this second half. First of all, quarterback Mike Teal has to play better. He was 6-for-15, a pair of interceptions in that first half. And defensively, they've got to get some pressure on Nick Davila because they had 23 sacks coming into this in the last four games, zero tonight. So they've got to turn up the pressure on Cincinnati's quarterback, and then their own quarterback's going to have to start playing better.
Dominic Goodman is deep with D'Angelo Smith. And this one is blasted out of the end zone. So Cincinnati will start from the 20. Here's the game track in case you joined us late. Davila has been terrific in his first career start. The former junior college All-American. Teal makes a couple of big mistakes. For Rutgers, that one turned into an 84-yard interception return. And on the final play of the half, another mistake by Teal, who was tremendous in the second half and the comeback win last week. He's going to need another one. And, Todd, you're right about the pressure they have to force on Cincinnati's offense. They have not done that tonight. Moore is back in there at tailback. Not much. Maybe 2 yards.
When you talk about Cincinnati, what's the biggest thing they have to do to maintain this momentum, to win this game? They can't turn it over again. Now, they've had three fumbles. They lost all three in that first half. They've got to protect the football in the second half. And then they can't be conservative offensively. They can't just think, okay, we've got a two-touchdown lead. Let's just run the ball right at them. They're still going to have to make some plays down the field in their passing game.
Their mistakes have only cost them 3 points. Moore again broke a tackle. Only 2 yards shy of a first down. Here's Holly Rowe.
Well, guys, I spoke with Cincinnati coach Mark D'Antonio at the half. He said he's really pleased in the first half with the composure of his quarterback, Nick Davila. Remember, this is his first start. He's a senior but hasn't played much. He said he really likes how he's able to get the ball out so quick, avoid that pressure from Rutgers, and that he's able to make long completions. He loves his composure. On the defensive side, he said, hey, we've been good against the run all year. I'm not surprised we're good against the run tonight.
All right, thanks, Ollie. And he's got to be thrilled with the way that first half went. His team just showed up very, very well in every department.
Well, and it's interesting, too, because when we talk to these coaches, especially the defensive coaches, they all said the same thing.
Illegal snap on the offense. Number 57, 5 yards. Repeat third down.
Big mistake. Todd takes him from third and two to third and seven.
Yeah, that is a big mistake. But Mark D'Antonio and all their coaches said the same thing. You know, this team fits us better. I mean, we know they're good and we respect them and we know they're a top-ranked team. But, you know, West Virginia, we didn't fit them too well with their speed and the way they spread out. But we fit defensively against this team, and we like to run the football. We think we can run right at these guys.
Play action by Davila, wants to throw. Incomplete, nearly intercepted.
Good coverage.
Intended for his tight end, Celek, but right there was Devin McCurtry.
A nice three and out by the Rutgers defense to start the third quarter. And you mentioned that penalty was huge. Third and two to third and seven. And now they have to punt the football. And Rutgers should get decent field position to start this first possession.
You see Greg Schiano just keep chopping, making that motion toward his team. We got a lot to chop right now. Down by two touchdowns. Foster, fair catch signal, makes it at the 35-yard line. No return after a 42-yard punt.
Again, Mike Teal, last week against Louisville, he was only 8 for 21, 189 yards, one touchdown, one interception. He was good at the end. He was 2 for 2 on the game-winning drive, made a big play on third down. He's got to step it up because right now the Cincinnati defense has kind of zeroed in on the running game. They've done a nice job against Ray Rice. And in order to open things up for Ray Rice, especially without a Brian Leonard that's not 100%, right, it's up to Mike Teal to loosen the defense up with his throwing.
He joined us late. Leonard pulled a hamstring in the first half. Rice runs into his own man and is buried at the line of scrimmage. In fact, he lost a yard. Let's go to Reese.
All right, Mike, in the battle for the Pac-10 championship, USC and California, sturdy Golden Bears trying to earn their way to the Rose Bowl for the first time since the 50s. The Taco Bell studio update, Nate Longshore to Lavelle Hawkins. First TD of the night, Cal is up by 3.
All right, thanks, Reese. A lot of people favored Cal coming into that ballgame. Thought they had a lot of balance. Teal with plenty of time, throws underneath, caught by Britt, but he's going to be short of the first down.
Yeah, I think it was a catch, but again, Mike Teal just a little bit behind his receiver. And this is one you want him to catch it without slowing down and falling down and be able to turn up field and make big yardage out of, because he's got the speed and he had a lot of open field in front of him. But the throw behind him, and Britt did a nice job slowing down and making the catch.
Third and one. Come out in a running formation. Rice on third and a yard has it.
Ray Rice with carry, right down by Anthony Oakes.
Rutgers needs to make this game shift in terms of momentum, and nothing would be better for them than a drive right here that results in a touchdown.
Well, I think right here too is a perfect time to go play action and try to throw the ball down the field for a big play. Again, Cincinnati is very run conscious right now. See if you can get those safeties to bite on the run or the linebackers, and see if you can get a throw down the field. Of course, they're in the shotgun, so that takes a little of that play action out of it.
There's the long pass, and it's intercepted. Mickens is right there again. We've seen him make bad plays. We've seen him make great plays.
But again, it's the throw by Teal too far to the inside. The defender has got inside technique, inside position on the receiver. So this ball has to be thrown up over the outside shoulder. See how far it drifted in? That turns right into the defensive back. If it's over the outside shoulder, he can't make a play. Inside, he's got a better track to the football than the receiver does.
Campbell couldn't get inside to play defensive back. Three interceptions for Teal in his last nine throws. It's still 17-3, and the undefeated Scarlet Knights keep shooting themselves in the foot. Butler Benson is the tailback from the 11-yard line. Right now, Todd, it's starting to look all in the world like Cincinnati is the better football team tonight.
Well, they're playing right with them. I mean, that's the way it is right now. And there's still a lot of football left in this game, and that's why Cincinnati, it'll be interesting to see just what happens from here on out with Rutgers. Are they able to turn up their intensity a little bit and recapture a little bit of what they had last week?
Betting again. The defense swarms on him at the 15. Rutgers is so quick, so active on defense.
Rutgers plays a lot of man coverage. They're going to press their corners, and they're going to play with their safeties close to the line of scrimmage. And they do a lot of stunning and twisting on the inside. They're very, very active, and they use their speed to their advantage. Big third down play here for Davila.
And last week when they were being pummeled by Louisville, no panic at all. They're not showing any panic tonight either. Davila to throw, steps up, takes off. And flags are down everywhere. It looked like one of the wide receivers was holding
Ernest Jackson. You know, and you're happy to see him give the effort to help the quarterback.
Holding on the Austin. Number 14, 10 yards from the spot of the foul. Repeat third down.
It is Jackson.
Yeah, and he didn't need to. I mean, he tries to become a blocker, what you want him to do. Here he is right here. And he's going to get called for the hold, blocking on Joe Porter. But I think Davila is going to make this first down no matter what Jackson does. Because right now he's across the first down marker. And another penalty on a third down situation that puts him in a tougher spot.
Coming into this game in not a whole lot of action, the longest run that Davila had all year long was 4 yards. So he is playing the game of his life in the Cincinnati uniform tonight. Now facing third and six. Straight back to throw this time, no pressure. Throws complete. Davila on target again. Goodman makes the catch.
But credit the protection again. Again, in the last four games, Rutgers, 23 sacks, none tonight. Watch this front five and the two backs. Seven-man protection. And a nice throw. Good pocket by the offensive line and an excellent throw for the first down. Little crossing route. Dominic Goodman, a former high school quarterback at Cincinnati Colerain High School, moved to wide receiver. Makes a big-time catch on third down.
Davila playing like he's been the starter all year long. Here comes the pressure. It's a screen. Benton. Breaks a tackle. Benton in the open field. To the five. And he takes it for 62. Great call.
And a great job by Davila setting it up. Not panicking, not rushing it, looking it off. And then we see the speed of Button. He's the guy that has the speed in that backfield. Excellent execution on the screenplay.
Jeffrey Linkenbach, the left tackle, had somebody pinned to the ground and just looked up as his receiver went flying by him. Gladauer is the tailback. Nothing doing. Gladauer, 6 feet, 225. local product from Cincinnati. Well, if Rutgers likes the role of underdog, if Cincinnati scores here, you can call them an underdog. You can call them anything you want. They're in hot water.
Would be surprised to see Davila coming on a little bootleg back to the left here. Left-handed quarterback fake to the right and come with a run-pass option back to the left side of the formation here.
He's already run for one touchdown. Moore.
Wow.
To the goal line. And they are going to mark it short.
Nice job by Trevor Canfield, the right guard, pulled around on the bob block. Fullback in there blocking as well, Marcus Waugh. And Moore, boy, I thought he got that.
This is a call I will never understand. The umpire is standing 3 inches away from the play. The umpire sees the ball hit the goal line. He does not make a call. He waits for one of the linesmen to come in and make the call for him. It is a procedural thing that is one of the most ridiculous things in the history of football. A guy sees a touchdown, he doesn't make the call. He waits for somebody who can't see it to make the call.
After this replay, I want you to tell me how you really feel about that procedure, Mike. I think his knee was down, though. I mean, I hear what you're saying, but watch and see if his knee's not down before the ball gets into the end zone. Knee is down, and then the ball crosses the plane.
That may very well be. I'll stand by my statement.
That's
anyway.
That's your story, and you're sticking
That's
with
right.
it. See, there's the knee down right there. And the ball has not crossed the plane of the end zone yet.
But there's the umpire who's got a pretty good look at it.
Play on the field is confirmed that the runner's knee is down at the half-yard line, third down.
That's a call that Rutgers desperately needs, and they need to make a play here on third down.
Now, third down and one. Here's where that lack of size on the Rutgers defense may come against them. Nobody over 270 pounds on the inside. They play with great leverage, but if the bigger offensive line for Cincinnati can get any push at all, Cincinnati should be able to power this one in.
Benton is the tailback on third and goal. Benton dives.
Flag down.
No touchdown signal. We'll check the marker. Brandon Rankert, the linebacker, went in the air the same time as Benton did and made the tackle.
I think the two defensive tackles were offside.
Offside. On the defense. Half the distance to the goal. Repeat the down.
That will be half the distance to the goal, which is about 2 inches.
Eric Foster right here looks like he's going to get into the neutral zone before the snap. Just a hair too soon.
Third and goal from 2 inches away. Waugh, the fullback. Benton, the tailback.
Wow.
And down goes Davila, coming over the top of the pile. Middle linebacker, Devron Thompson. He timed it perfectly.
Well, we've seen McCullough for Cincinnati time that blitz. Watch Thompson come right over his own man and time it perfectly. Over his own man, over the center, and right onto the back of Davila.
Reminiscent of a play LeVar Arrington made at Penn State. What a sensational play.
Very smart play, anticipating the snap count.
And it forces a field goal. From 20 yards. And if that doesn't lift Rutgers' spirits, nothing will. It's still 20-3, but they kept him out of the end zone. back in Cincinnati where the Bearcats are stunning Rutgers. Let's go back to that great play, Todd.
Well, because the motion is going to come this way by Doug Jones. When you see Devron Thompson come in here, he can time that up because with motion, the snap count has to be pretty consistent. And it's a really smart play by Thompson because it's third and goal. Even if he gets called for offsides, they're just going to move it 6 inches closer to the goal line and it's still third down. He timed it up with the motion and made a beautiful play.
That's remarkable.
And that might even be a game-saving play.
Yeah, it sure could be.
By the time this thing all unfolds, holding them to three right there might be the difference in the game.
86-yard drive for Cincinnati. Beautifully done. Took 5:27 off the clock. Townsend and Foster are deep. And Rutgers will have to start at the 27-yard line. Here's today's Good Hands Flashback, presented by Allstate. 1999 Cincinnati against number 9 Wisconsin. Robert Cooper, 51 yards to give Cincinnati a 7-3 lead. Then the Cats went up 14-6 midway through the fourth quarter. Ron Dane did them a huge favor, fumbled on the 2-yard line. Cincinnati ends up winning the game 17-12. Their only win against a top 10 team. Tonight would be another one and an even bigger victory in the Big East. Leonard gets a carry. Rare for him tonight for a couple.
And Rutgers going to a no huddle now, trying to speed up the tempo of the game. This is not a panic move. This is just some way to try to change the tempo of the game in their favor.
Pass complete for a first down outside the 40 to the tight end Clark Harris. Let's go to Reese.
All right, Mike, putting our finger on the prime time pulse. On ABC, Cal and USC at the half. Cal up 9-6 and college football living on ESPN2 where Virginia Tech is living high on the hog. Wake can still make the ACC title game, but they're getting pummeled by the Hokies late in the fourth tonight.
All right, Reese. Leonard is the tailback in this formation. He'll get a carry. And had his legs cut out from under him at the 40-yard line.
Boy, McCullough is playing a whale of a ball
game.
You know, he talked to us, and Holly mentioned at the beginning of the game that he had a horrible taste in his mouth after this game last year. They went up to Piscataway. They lost 44-9. They had nothing going for him, nothing to play for.
Almost another interception as that ball was overthrown. John Bowie was the closest one to it and nearly had a pick.
John Bowie, we weren't even sure whether he was going to play tonight. Did not practice all week. Great speed, the Big East 100-meter sprint champion. Had a swollen knee all week, but he's been in there the whole night, just not able to come down with that interception. Good coverage by the Bearcats.
McCullough, middle linebacker, was fun to talk to. Said he got some great pointers from Chris Spielman on how to watch film. Third and 11. Rutgers has to get something going on offense. Teal under pressure. Throws underneath. The catch made by Kenny Britt, but well shy of a first down. And if you're wearing Rutgers red tonight, it's not nearly as good as Cincinnati red. Webster made the last tackle. The Rutgers fans who made this trip not expecting this. Radigan to punt to Stewart. They've had plenty of opportunities tonight. They have just not taken advantage of them. Stewart, fair catch signal, fights it and makes it at the 17-yard line after a punt of 39. The Bearcats trying to become bowl eligible. What a way to do it. They're up 20-3 on Rutgers.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Dodge. You can take life as it comes, or you can grab life by the horns. Dodge. And Allstate. Are you in good hands?
serving chili over spaghetti or noodles goes back to credit the Greek immigrants in the early 1920s. And now Cincinnati, famous for its chili, consuming more than 2 million pounds of chili each year, topped by 850,000 pounds of shredded cheddar cheese. Well,
did you see that? Have a little chili with your cheese.
Oh, wow. Holy. Davila throws on the run, as his tight end Brent Celek. Celek looks for a couple of blocks across the 50, 40, 30. Celek still at his feet at the
wow.
10.
Touchdown. Are you kidding me?
83 yards. And Celek may have hurt himself on that play.
Well,
he probably doesn't care.
He came into the game with a little bum shoulder, and we saw him in the training room on Friday getting extra treatment on his shoulder, but he laid it on the line on that play.
Boy, what an effort by Celek.
I said earlier they needed to give him the football. He's their best receiver, and they passed on him on the last bootleg. That time, Davila went to him right away. What a play.
Celebrating senior night, and now he'll get some treatment on that shoulder. But he just made the play of his life.
He's one of the 22 or 23 local players, Cincinnati guys, played at LaSalle High School. Senior night. Boy, I don't see him stepping out of bounds yet.
He's no. still
in. What an effort. What an unbelievable individual effort.
He is a very thoughtful, very nice young man who has a lot of talent, and it was on display right there. Their leading receiver coming into this ball game. If he doesn't make it in the NFL, he wants to start his own business.
One of the ways you know how much a kid means to his teammates.
Has confirmed the ruling on the field. Touchdown.
Well, he's their leading receiver. You pointed out they needed to get him the ball. He finally makes a catch and goes 85 yeah. yards for a touchdown.
I'm going to make the most of my first catch.
Well, they need to listen to you more often.
What a great play. Two-time team captain, 2 years in a row. That shows you the respect his teammates have for Brent Celek.
His little brother is a senior in high school, probably headed to Cincinnati as a tight end. And Celek's feeling a lot better right now. Rutgers is not. The Scarlet Knights are being mugged in Cincinnati. The party has started in Cincinnati. The Bearcats on top of undefeated Rutgers 27-3. Tonight's senior night in Cincinnati. Brent Celek with his parents, one of the seniors getting an ovation before the game, Steve and Debbie, who have enjoyed watching their son's career here.
Well, we just saw Celek sell that play by coming inside on the block. Now we see the speed. We see the strength at the end to bust that tackle. And the toughness. He used that bad shoulder to knock that last tackler off, but nothing was going to keep him out of the end zone. Wonderful individual effort. And how about the night of Nick Davila in his first start, 8 of 11, 252 yards passing against a good defense.
And everything going Cincinnati's way. Let's go to Reese Davis. Reese.
Mike, this might be the stunner of the day. Colonel Reb is not crying. He's smiling. Ben Jarvis Green Ellis going in for the Rebels at LSU, up by 10 halfway through the third quarter. And Boise State, 11-0. They can finish off against Nevada. They have a great, great shot, automatically qualifying for a BCS game, 49-10 over Utah State.
Well, good for them. Congratulations to Boise State. Can Rutgers gather itself mentally to make a run here? You have to wonder. Clark Harris makes the tackle up to the 35. They've been down before, but I don't think they've ever looked this bad and been down. We're at Nippert Stadium in Cincinnati, where the Bearcats are facing their fifth top 10 opponent. Rutgers is playing as a top 10 team for the first time ever, but they're not playing like a top 10 team.
Well, and here's the problem for Rutgers right now. I mean, they're in a hurry-up offense, and they've got to throw the football, obviously, but in this situation, down 27-3, their best player on their team, Ray Rice, is on the sidelines. He's not even on the field because they need Leonard in there for pass protection and receiving. So Ray Rice has been taken out of the game for Rutgers because they're so far behind and they have to throw. So when they were behind by Louisville, Ray Rice had a big fourth quarter running the football during that comeback. 10 carries for 75 yards in the fourth quarter. This is a little different set of circumstances for the Scarlet Knights.
And Rice's strength is not as a receiver. He's only caught four balls all year.
Or as a pass protector.
Right.
That's why you need Leonard in there.
Third and six. 2:16 to go third quarter. Three-man rush. Teal underneath, just trying to keep the drive alive to Tyquan Underwood.
There's a flag down as well.
Would have enough for a first down out to the 45-yard line. We'll check the marker.
Offsides on the defense. The defensive end, a penalty decline, first down.
Mark D'Antonio doing everything he can to keep his team's focus. Broken up, guess who? Mickens, and another flag is down. This would be the third interference call. That, watching it live, looked like a great play by Mickens.
Well, when we look at this again, he's going to make a great play with his left hand.
Pass interference on the defense. Number 21, 15 yards from the line of scrimmage. Automatic first down.
He's going to make a great play with his left hand and commit a foul with his right hand. Watch. Right hand over the head, left hand on the football. I mean, that's a good call. He's in pretty good position, but that left hand grabbed the helmet, and then he knocked the ball away.
I was watching the left hand. I didn't see the one that sneaked up on the face of the receiver or the right hand. Of course, Mickens sold it pretty well. He came up screaming like I couldn't have done anything wrong that time.
Meanwhile, another drop ball for Rutgers, second and 10.
It was Dennis Campbell who couldn't hang on to that one.
This is just not how Rutgers is built for this kind of a comeback. They are not a drop back and throw it 35-40. They only had one game where they threw the ball for over 200 yards, and that was against Navy this season.
And Teal has not made these kind of mistakes. Blitz coming. What a block by Leonard. Incomplete, now intercepted. Right in the hands of Williams.
Tyquan Underwood didn't even know the ball was coming to him. I think the ball just bounced right off of his hip.
It bounced off of somebody, and Williams ended up being in the right place.
One of the rare blitzes for Cincinnati, being aggressive, and Underwood, he never even looked for the ball. It just hit off of him and bounced up in the air, and Williams came down with the interception. It's a blitz read for the quarterback. The receiver didn't see it.
It ended up being behind him, and for Teal, a career-high fourth interception. But you're right, Underwood never saw the ball. He was looking at the coverage. He was watching the safeties that were coming down on him. And Cincinnati going to go to work on the ground. Gladauer taken out of bounds, and a little pushing and shoving afterward.
A little frustration play at the end of that play by the safety, Courtney Green.
Obviously. And the flag is down.
Obviously, this is a very frustrating situation for Rutgers right now. They can't stop Cincinnati with their defense. They can't sustain anything with their offense. And Cincinnati has 350 yards of offense.
There is no foul for unnecessary roughness.
I think a pretty good call there to pick that up.
I kind of do, too. Gladar's still running. And I mean, he tried to hold him up at the end. And think about this. They held Louisville, that came into the game averaging almost 500 yards of offense. They held them to 266 yards of offense last week. Tonight already, Cincinnati 350.
They came after Louisville at every opportunity. Thompson makes another stop. Let's go to Holly.
Well, guys, Cincinnati coach Mark D'Antonio was with Jim Tressel at Ohio State for a long time. He won a national championship with Coach Tressel, and he's taken some great things from him. This is the winner's manual. This is a big thing that they do at Ohio State, and he brought it here to Cincinnati. This book has everything in it. The plan. It has chapters about history, the United States of America. But the most important chapter right now for me, guys, this was a lesson from August 16th, handling adversity. You take a setback and turn it into a comeback. That's what they've done after a 44-9 loss last year. Guys, so far the winner's manual gave them some great advice.
And what has given them a tremendous spark tonight, Holly, is Nick Davila. He has been absolutely brilliant in his first career start. That pass complete to Kareem Ali, one of three good tight ends this club has.
And Mark D'Antonio not only has to be thrilled with his quarterback, but also his offensive line, because they have kept his quarterback safe. They have given him time to throw. He hasn't thrown the ball a lot because they've been able to run it with some success, too. But he has been very accurate when he's thrown the football tonight.
Cincinnati has played the most difficult schedule in the country. A flag down is Gladauer's tackle. But it's one thing to play five top 10 opponents. But in order to make something like that count, you have to beat somebody. Tonight, they are beating number 7, an undefeated Rutgers.
And they have played brilliantly at home. They've had 6 home games this year. They're 5-1 at home. No team has even run the football for over 100 yards against them. Right now, Rutgers, the 15th best in the country.
On the defense, the left end was in the neutral zone. 5 yards, beat the down. First down.
Rutgers only 56 yards rushing tonight, and they were the 15th best in the country.
Yeah.
So for whatever reason, at home, and you say, well, they played some of their easier games at home. Maybe so, but at home, they have played outstanding football, particularly defensively.
One of the frustrating things for Cincinnati football, even though they're playing this well, they've only drawn 27,000 tonight to face an undefeated team in their own conference. 15 minutes to go. 27-3. The dream on the verge of ending for Rutgers. Can they reawaken in the fourth quarter? ESPN's College Football Primetime is broadcast in high definition and presented by Pioneer Plasma Displays. You joined us late. It has been all Cincinnati. They took the lead 3-0. They have not let up. It's 27-3 Bearcats. And Rutgers' dream of an undefeated season and a shot at a national championship is 15 minutes away from disappearing. Gladauer hit in the backfield and spun down by Ramel Meekins. Neither one of these teams came in noted for their quarterback play, but Davila has changed that. 9 out of 12 for 260. It is first career start, and look at Teal. Only 86 yards, 4 huge picks.
And for Davila, 9 completions to 8 different receivers. And remember, the first play of the game, he fumbled the snap. All of that after that.
Gladauer drilled as he got to the 38-yard line. Here's Holly.
Well, guys, Nick Davila came in preseason. The job was open, and he competed neck and neck with Grutza. The coaches actually took a vote after fall camp to see who should be their starter going into the season, and it was split right down the middle. So this is a guy who has competed down through the wire, is a guy who has all the talent and ability in the world, but just got beat out at the last second. He's showing tonight that he really could be the starter if given the opportunity like he was tonight.
Well, they felt that he gave them a better passing option, a quicker release, a little stronger arm.
Threw this one out in the flat. Ball comes loose. They got it back.
Wow. Now that's when you know that the bounces are going your way, because that one was laying there. There were three Rutgers defenders around there, and somehow Poland comes back up with the football.
It's Jared Martin out in the flat. Now watch the ball.
It's laying there, and here they come converging, and somehow Martin's going to end up with it.
Had it tipped right back to him. But Rutgers is not going to be able to say it was a series of bad breaks tonight. They've been handled. Gladauer again. Stays on his feet and fights down to the 25-yard line.
You know, and I don't, I know that, you know, the, I hate that term, trap game. You know, the media uses that term as Rice is a trap game. And I don't think that's a, football guys don't use that term. You know, I mean, because you know every week you know you have to play well. And especially if you're a successful team. I don't see this as much as being a letdown by Rutgers as much as it is a lift up by Cincinnati. I mean, they had an embarrassing game last week, and they have come to play tonight.
I agree with you. Davila hit at the sideline. That was close to being an extra 15 from Thompson, but Davila, to his credit, just runs right back to the huddle after getting another first down.
Good decision by Davila. You don't have anything. There's no need to force a bad throw. Just get what you can get and get out of bounds. But even on that play, I mean, you see Rutgers flying to the football. You don't see anybody dragging. You don't see anybody quitting. They just haven't executed. Offensively, they've not been very good with the football.
And you made a great point. You got to take your hat off to Cincinnati more than you criticize Rutgers.
And I think the quarterback and the offensive line have won this game so far for Cincinnati. They've controlled this Rutgers defensive front.
Gladauer. Three tailbacks have run the ball pretty well. This tailback by committee thing has worked out rather well for the Bearcats. Now, Rutgers is going to have to regroup with this score holds. They still have to play Syracuse and West Virginia as their regular season winds down, and they're going to have to get over the shock of that first defeat after riding such a tremendous wave. Second and 10. Smart play by Davila, just throws that one away. Let's go to Reese.
All right, Mike, LSU is in a world of trouble against Ole Miss, but Jamarcus Russell has the kind of arm that can get you out of trouble. I want you to watch the big fella and how far he throws this football. Turns it loose from about his own 8 off his back foot and hits early Doucette inside the Ole Miss 40, but it's still 20-7 Rebels.
Well, he's fallen the other way. He's got that Brett Favre kind of arm, John Elway kind of arm. Davila throws as he's hitting a perfect strike to Ali.
How quick that ball gets out of his hands in the face of a blitz. And that's what the coach has told us. We think he gives us a better chance because the ball really gets out quick. Here's a blitz. Unblocked guy. You know he's coming. No wasted motion by Davila. And he throws another completion.
Well, that's pretty good for a guy who doesn't play.
Dustin Grutz is probably glad that Nick Davila is a senior. Man. Big time performance.
Played 2 years of junior college ball in California. 2-year JUCO All-American. Came in last year, nearly won the job this year. Finally getting a chance to play on senior night, making the most of it. Brent Celek, the tight end who had that tremendous touchdown catch and run earlier in the ball game.
And you know he must be banged up a little bit because he's not on the field right now. I mean, he's the team captain, the offensive captain, not in there right now, down here on the 10-yard line. They've got some depth at tight end. They've got a couple good young tight ends that are in the ball game right now.
Fourth and one. This will be the 12th play of the drive as they disdain the field goal, decide to go for it. Gladauer over the top, first down and goal.
Gladauer, another one of those local guys from Cincinnati Elder. The Greater Catholic League down here in Cincinnati. Great athletic tradition. Elder, Bowler, LaSalle, St. X.
Boy, Todd, they've made the plays tonight.
They have. They have. And again, this offensive line has just been outstanding.
It's obviously a prime recruiting area for Ohio State. And Cincinnati trying to keep some of the local products at home. They've done a good job with it. And trying to make the Big East a little more of a destination than the Big Ten to grab some more of those players. 20 players from Cincinnati, 62 of 102 from the state of Ohio.
And again, you mentioned Ohio State. Of course, they kind of dominate the state with the cream of the crop, the guys they want. You've got a lot of Mid-American Conference schools that play good football that recruit this state very well.
Gladauer. Not much there. Picks up maybe a yard to the nine and the middle linebacker. Thompson again on the stop.
You talk about the letdown. Was there a letdown for Rutgers tonight? It's impossible to have the exact same kind of energy and enthusiasm they had last week or last Thursday night against Louisville at home. I mean, you can't maintain the same level week in and week out. There's bound to be a little dips and peaks and valleys, but this was more about Cincinnati, I think, than it was about Rutgers.
I agree. Gladauer again staying in bounds. He'll be stopped back near the 11-yard line by Courtney Green, the free safety, who was the leading tackler on this team, a freshman All-American a year ago, and a very talented player in the secondary.
I think one of the biggest things, again, we've talked about the offensive line, the pass protection, but, you know, for Rutgers defense coming in with so many sacks and that being a big calling card for their defense, 35 sacks coming into the game, and they feed off of that energy that sacks create. Well, they haven't been able to get to Davila tonight, and that's taken some steam out of this Rutgers defense, no question.
Not only his quick release, but as you pointed out, a tremendous job by the offensive line. They have really hung in there and giving him great protection. Field goal is good from 27. Cincinnati raises the count again. The story tonight, the Bearcats have made the plays. The Scarlet Knights have not. The last drive, only 48 yards, but it took 7.5 minutes off the clock and ran 16 plays. And it's 30-3. Rutgers needs 4 touchdowns in a little over 9 minutes. Foster. No blockers out there, and Foster's forced out of bounds to the 36-yard line. Let's take a look at the ESPNU All-State Standings review, and obviously another shakeup at the top. Michigan loses today. USC is losing today. Rutgers is down big. 3 of the top 6 with the potential to go out. The question is, Todd, did Michigan's performance against Ohio State keep them high enough in the BCS poll to justify a rematch? And Teal sacked, hit from behind by Terrell Byrd.
Well, part of the situation right now for Cincinnati is they know that the running game is gone for Rutgers. So it's pass every down. Let's just pin our ears back and get to the quarterback. And that's what Byrd did.
Here they come again. Teal throws it up to the corner. There's a flag down. The catch made by Underwood. He may have pushed off to get free.
That was offensive pass interference and good pressure that time by Curtis Young, number 94.
Boy, Mickens back there in the secondary, seen enough flags tonight, hasn't he? Either for or against him.
Pass interference on the offense. Number 16, 15 yards from the line of scrimmage. Repeat first down.
Well, it had to be number 7, Underwood. He was the intended receiver.
16, 7.
Close enough. If they had declined. I was thinking if it declined the penalty, it would have been 3rd and 17. Instead, they choose to back him up in 3rd and 32. Or 2nd and 32, rather. Teal on a roll as they move the pocket. Britt with the catch, trying to stay on his feet, gets it out to the 37-yard line. Check in with Reese.
Mike Troy Smith always saves his best for Michigan. Sports Center 30 at 30 update. Smith hugging Jim Tressel before the game. Despite Mike Hart's big day, the Buckeyes got 316 yards passing from Smith. Good running from Antonio Pittman. They beat Michigan in a classic 42-39. Byron Leftwich has to have surgery. Status for the rest of the season unknown. Sports Center after the game. ESPN News all the time. And college football final at midnight, fellas.
All right, Reese, thanks very much. 7:44 and counting here in Cincinnati. Teal on 3rd and long, trying to keep it alive. Throws short, and it's complete to his tight end, Clark Harris. But not anywhere near enough yardage for a first down. Why do you make that throw?
Well, the only reason you make that throw is if the defense forces you to make that throw. If there's nothing else available. Cincinnati playing a lot of zone right now and trying to force underneath throws. This time, he's got to throw it past the marker.
4th and 12, and gets it downfield. That is very, very close. It looks like they're going to mark it about a foot now. They move it down a yard on Townsend's catch. It will be enough for a first down.
Well, good job by Townsend knowing what he needed for the first down, getting to that mark. He can't see that yellow line like we can, but he knew where he needed to go for the first down.
So Teal keeps that drive alive. Now he goes to the sideline. There's another flag down, which will stop the clock with 6:53 to go.
It's probably holding where it was thrown.
Holding. On the offense, number 77, 10 yards from the line of scrimmage, repeat first down.
Well, if you're Cincinnati, you're going to walk out of here with your chest puffed up right. And say, "What? Look what we did. We beat an undefeated team, the number 7 team in the country. Yep. We've become bowl eligible. Yep. We have a chance to win next week and go 7-5 and now have a great taste in their mouth finishing the season.
Yep. I mean, they're gonna put this, a lot of highlights of this on their highlight reel for the season.
Teal deep and incomplete.
They're going to get to take their team to another bowl game. They've got one more game at Connecticut next week. A chance to finish with 7 wins.
Boy, and if you're Rutgers, you're going to walk out of here saying, "What happened?"
But I mean, Cincinnati, you got to feel good that they played those tough teams, top 10 teams. Yep. They lost all 4 of them on the road. They get one at home. They win at home. Or winning at home, I should say.
And Mark D'Antonio and his coaching staff deserve all the credit in the world for keeping his team focused so they would come out and perform this way. That was Leonard on the screen, couldn't get anything out of it.
This is a chance also to really build. I mean, you know, I've been impressed with the facilities here and the football building and what they've done here, facilities-wise.
Yeah.
Done some nice things to historic Nippert Stadium. They just need to get more people coming to the games right now. This is a pretty good football team that deserves to be supported better than they're being supported right now.
Well, the facility is a huge part of it, and the football building is beautiful.
And I think if they can continue to recruit this state well and recruit the city of Cincinnati particularly well, maybe that will build up enough local interest to draw more people out. I know it's a pro city with the Bengals here, but I like Mark D'Antonio and his staff and what they're trying to do here with the Bearcats.
Teal going back to work. Clark Harris, the tight end, breaks a tackle. Harris to the 10, 5, to the 1.
Great effort.
D'Angelo Smith at least temporarily saved the touchdown. It's a gain of 66, and Harris, who is a very good tight end, makes the big play.
Well, we saw the beautiful individual effort by Brent Celek, the tight end for Cincinnati. Here's Harris, catches it in traffic, and then just pulls away. They tried to grab his jersey to pull him down and not able to get the big fella down. Good catch with his hands in traffic.
Cincinnati running players on late. Ray Rice with the ball. There is a flag down. I don't think everybody got onside in time.
And how cold must Ray Rice be? He's been on the sideline forever, and they bring him in because they're finally in a situation they can get in an I formation.
Ryan Leonard, the ball carrier.
Offsides. On the defense, the substitution did not get in the defensive backfield. Half the distance, repeat first down.
Mark D'Antonio's had a good defense all year long. Except for West Virginia, they held people to very low totals on the ground. And Ray Rice will get into the end zone for a touchdown here at the 5:34 mark.
But they've been right on that track for what they've done at home. Defensively at home, they've held people to under 100 yards rushing. Rutgers right now at 49. And they've kept people out of the end zone. They've averaged, they've given up 11 points a game at home. 5-1 home record. And right now, Rutgers trying to put their 10th point on the scoreboard.
Yeah, they're going to try for 10 and 11.
Yep.
As Leonard will be the only setback. They move the ball. You have a choice. They move the ball to the near hash mark. And Teal will throw the fade, and it's complete to Underwood for two.
Mike Teal's pass is complete to Tyquan Underwood.
5:34 to go in the ball game. Rutgers still three scores down.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Remington Titanium Shavers and Sharp Aquas. Nothing is lost.
That's the new football building we told you about, the Lindner Athletic Center. The centerpiece of the new construction here opened in May of this year. It's got all the trophies, including going all the way back to Oscar Robertson when Cincinnati won a couple national championships with the Big O. And they did a great job on that building. Set up for an onside kick here is Rutgers as they get their first touchdown of the ballgame with 5:34 left. And now they will go to the other side. Loose ball taken by Cincinnati.
Well, pretty nice adjustment. Again, they've got depth at tight end. That was Doug Jones, who lines up at fullback and tight end.
Doug Jones.
Rutgers tried to fool him by shifting, faking the kick one way, shifting a few more bodies to the other side, then quick kicking it to the other side, and Doug Jones covered the football.
It's a great attempt at a formation. Very smart play by Rutgers, but it didn't work.
Well, and that's, again, the rule in college football. You can only have six guys, no more than six guys on one side of the ball. So in order to get them over there and try to get some kind of trickery into it, you have to do something like that. Nice execution, but good play by Cincinnati.
Greg Moore back in tailback, and you're going to get a a big dose of the running game right now. Frierson with the tackle. Let's check in with Reese.
All right, Mike, LSU trying to rally itself from what would be an embarrassing loss at home to Ole Miss, down 20-7 in the fourth. Jamarcus Russell finding early Doucette. 20-14 now, 7.5 to go in Tiger Stadium. Cal and USC, what has happened? The Pac-10's playing like the Big Ten. The Big Ten playing like the Pac-10. 9-9 for the Pac-10 championship, starting the fourth on ABC.
All right, Reese, thanks very much. And Holly Rowe down on the field with a special interview. Holly.
Here with Nick Davila's parents. Fernando, what did you think when you first found out your son was going to get his to start his first game ever as a senior?
Well, it was just answered prayer. He has a strong faith in God, and his prayers just came true, you know, and he's having fun out there tonight.
What went through your mind when he fumbled the very first handoff?
Well, I talked to him before the game, and he said he was a little bit nervous, but after he threw his first pass, he was okay after that.
What do you think he's going to feel like after this, one of the biggest wins in school history, and he did it, his last performance?
Well, this is what he's been working for since he was a kid, and he's just been trained to do this, and he's doing it now on the field, and offense is playing outstanding tonight. The defense is playing great. It's an all-around great game tonight.
All right, well, congratulations on a great performance by your son. Guys?
Got to be such a proud night for him. Rutgers used a timeout to stop the clock. I think that's a great move by Greg Schiano. They'll try to save just as much as possible as Moore picks up a couple and there's a flag down. You got to save as much of that time as you can and hope to get the ball back, score again, and then get a couple more onside kicks.
Holdings on the offense. Number 66, 10 yards. Second down.
You know, I just want to add something about Nick Davila because, you know, it is great to see this kind of performance and senior night and all that, but it's a real testament also when you talk about a guy who's a backup, and a backup quarterback doesn't play like a backup linebacker who might play on special teams or sub in. And it's difficult because you don't know when you're going to get any game time, and sometimes it's maybe just mop-up duty. But you tell the guy you got to keep preparing like you're a starting quarterback because you never know, you're one snap away from being the starter. And he came in last week and played very well when the game was out of hand at West Virginia. But he was 10 for 17, 167 yards and 2 touchdowns. Well, now this week, Dustin Groots is hurt, and they don't know whether he gives us the best chance to win or whether we saw last week that Davila could play a little bit and was ready to play. They made the switch to go to him tonight, and he was ready to step into that opportunity. And that's what's great to see, when a guy is ready to take that opportunity and make the best of it.
I would think it would take tremendous mental discipline to be ready for that opportunity.
Yeah. Well, yeah, you just have to fight through the frustration of not playing and fight through the frustration of maybe parents or family members or girlfriends saying, hey, you should be starting or you should be playing or whatever, and just keep doing what you have to do. Take a look at what he's done tonight. And remember, he fumbled the opening snap. And then he came back from that and has had a beautiful game. It started out by running for a touchdown. And then against a team that has sacked everybody they've played, he's been right on the money. Very accurate. He's kept this Rutgers defense off balance all night. 11 for 15, 277 yards, and a touchdown.
He looks like one of those kids. There are some people who are just very natural, guys that understand the game, that the game is mentally very simple for them, that they understand that, you know, A goes with B, and things just work in a certain way. And you wonder if a kid like this, who had such a sensational junior college career, if he has a couple more games to finish up this season, if somebody's going to give him a free agent shot at the next level just based on what he's done at the end of the year.
Well, he might. I mean, he looked good tonight. I mean, he has a strong arm. Obviously, he's been very, very accurate. It's interesting because the coaches told us the real strength of Dustin Groza, the younger quarterback, was his command of the offense and just his feel for the offense. Well, it's hard to imagine anybody has a better feel than Nick Davila does
his
of this
pretty
offense
good.
Tonight.
That's pretty good.
Yeah, he was
and
good.
He'll. This is something he'll remember for the rest of his life. Absolutely. No matter what he does from now on, whether it's playing quarterback or, you know, working in business or whatever, he'll remember this night.
And you remember.
remember the life lesson also of waiting and being ready to capitalize on an opportunity, yep, and not giving up hope, persevering, and doing it when it's hard. You know, doing the preparation and things you have to do when everybody else says, well, I'll just take the rest of the season off.
Nick Brian did. Brian Steele's going to punt for only the third time. Rutgers has used a timeout again to stop the clock, and Steele with a beautiful high kick that will just make the end zone. But his job was just to get the ball out of there. Coming up after the game, Neil Everett and John Anderson will have SportsCenter, including who's in contention for the BCS title game. Cowboys against Peyton Manning, what they have to do, and chasing Jimmy Johnson, who needs to do what in the NASCAR final race to win the Nextel Cup. Anybody against Peyton Manning is a daunting task. The guy is as good as it gets. Rutgers needs a series of miracles. And almost picked off, guess who? Mickens again. Let's go to Reese Davis. Reese?
Mike, on ABC, Cal and USC tied up at 9. Fourth quarter, still early there. John David Booty fires a dart. Wayne Jarrett takes a lick, hangs on to the ball. Trojans up by 7 in the fourth.
Jarrett, when Jarrett was out, their passing game really declined. It's a huge weapon. Teal, good protection, throws into triple coverage intended for Clark Harris.
I'll tell you what's amazing to me, just the irony of today's action in college football. That game going on right there, the Pac-10, you think of great offenses, high scoring. It's 16-7, a defensive struggle. The Big Ten, you think more of a low-scoring defense. Ohio State, the number one scoring defense in the country. Michigan, the number one rush defense. That was a 42-39 game today. That's an amazing turnaround.
Now, if you give up 42 points, as Michigan did, do you deserve a rematch for a national championship game? You won a loss.
But you scored 39, too.
Yeah.
In Columbus.
Teal throws. This one's complete. Good catch by Kenny Britt. His 7th grab of the night, and they've got a first down in midfield.
Well, Cincinnati's going to rush 3. They're going to drop 8 into coverage. They just don't want anything to get behind their deepest defenders. They'll give some underneath throws and try to run that clock.
Teal throws behind Harris, and this one was nearly picked off again. Mickens has been right in the middle of everything.
Well, I don't know what happened to that ball. I don't know if it slipped out of Teal's hands or if it got hit or what, but it came out really strangely. Well, there it is. He got hit. A little blitz from the outside. Hit his arm.
Trips wide receivers to the right side. Teal goes over the middle, short to Britt. And he's to the 41, about a yard shy of a first down. Cincinnati will let him have every one of those they want.
You mentioned,
8 for 86 for Britt.
You mentioned how Chris Spielman worked with Kevin McCullough and taught him about watching film. Also talked to some of the other defensive players. Of course, he knew D'Antonio from his days at Ohio State.
The interesting thing about Chris is not only did he tell him to watch the end zone view, which is what he would see as a middle linebacker, he told him to stand up. You know, don't sit down. Watch 3 hours of film while you're standing up like you would as a middle linebacker. Yeah. Well, everybody else sits down. Spielman still stood up.
Well, and he also, he would stand the chairs up like defensive linemen, and he would watch it, and he said, don't watch cut-ups either. Watch the whole game and get the feel of the whole flow of the game and make the calls and run through in your mind and also your steps, what you would do.
Teal has that one tipped, still caught by Leonard. you know, Spielman was such a great player. One more thought about him. But the thing that impressed me more than his tremendous ability and intensity as a football player is when he gave up a year of his career to be with his wife while she fought cancer. I thought that was one of the most remarkable things that I have ever seen an athlete do. This is almost intercepted again, intended for Underwood. D'Angelo Smith, who had a big one earlier, was over there in the coverage. Britt, who was shaking a couple of plays earlier, back on the field for the Rutgers Scarlet Knights. Still trying to cut into that lead. Teal will hang it up in the end zone. Harris trying to jump for it, and Mickens nearly had the ball again.
It's kind of risk-reward with that guy, isn't it?
Isn't it?
He's around the ball, and people are throwing at him. He's had three interference calls, but he's had a couple of picks as well. This time he gets a knockdown.
He gets involved, that's for sure. Third and 10, down to 3:06 on the game clock. Rutgers still needs three big scores. Blitz coming. Teal to Britt. Fighting for extra yardage. They need to get to the 22 for a first down. Obviously, this is four down territory. Greg Schiano seeing the dream ticking away of an undefeated season. Teal throws too high, incomplete. And they can start celebrating in Cincinnati. They get the ball back with 2:36 to go in the game. This is going to be the signature win that they have looked for, facing a brutal schedule this year.
Well, there's 2:36 left, and I see the Cincinnati players getting the water ready. They're getting the Gatorade ready. I see Leo Morgan, number 55.
Oh,
they
yeah.
got the Gatorade. They're hiding. See, they got the human shield hiding them. But Mark D'Antonio is going to get it.
Yes, he is.
2.5 minutes.
And he'll enjoy it, too.
Absolutely.
He may get it sooner than later. Benton is in as the tailback. And Rutgers has used its final timeout with 2:16 on the clock. And here is tonight's Sharp Aquas image of the game. And it's Brent Celek with a tremendous individual performance. The tight end weaving his way for a touchdown, showing not only speed but strength and determination, with a bad shoulder, lowering that shoulder to get the final yards. And Davila, the quarterback, with a brilliant job tonight.
And Celek has not played another play since that, other than the onside kick. He was on the field for the onside kick, a bad shoulder. His one catch for the night. Wow, what a catch. What an effort.
If you're going to make one, that's the kind to make.
I tell you, we've said Nick Davila's name a bunch of times tonight, and deservedly so. I just want to say the names of these offensive linemen that have played for Cincinnati tonight, because they've done a great job. Jeffrey Lickenbach, the left tackle. Frank Straub, the left guard. Jeff Reinstatler, the center. Trevor Canfield, the right guard. And Digger Bujnak, the right tackle, have been outstanding in protecting and opening running lanes for this Cincinnati offense.
Good job on the pronunciations as well.
Some tough ones too.
Sports Center coming up next. Gatorade waiting for that precisely correct moment, which is not going to be too far away. Mark D'Antonio will even his record at Cincinnati tonight at 17-17, the biggest win in his tenure here. And this will have a dramatic impact on the Big East standings. Rutgers will now have one loss, as does West Virginia and Louisville, but Rutgers and West Virginia will play each other, so it is not going to be a three-way tie. And the happiest people about tonight's outcome outside of Cincinnati are in Louisville. Yep. They are thrilled because they have the tiebreaker on West Virginia by virtue of their victory.
As you look at that standings also, six Big East teams bowl eligible. That's Cincinnati getting bowl eligible tonight.
And a couple of them, West Virginia and Louisville, may be looking at BCS bowls. Yeah. 41 seconds to go. And the smile on the face of Mark D'Antonio, who knows this one has been wrapped up. Let's go to Holly Rowe. Holly?
Well, guys, as you can see in one end zone, they're already putting the goalpost down. Ironically enough, just last night, they installed these new collapsible goalposts. I talked to the operations guys, and I said, why did you do it last night? They said, well, we wanted to be ready when we win, not if we win, when we win. They believed all along.
Well, Holly, you got to give them credit. If they believed that this was possible, they certainly proved it tonight.
But I don't get, what are they doing with the sticks? I mean, who does it? Does the work crew take the goalpost down or what? Ah, the Gatorade.
They are so happy for him right now. Mark D'Antonio so happy for the team. 41 seconds to go in the game. Fourth and four. And they will attempt to kick it away against a big rush. They get it out of there. Nobody back. And it will take a bounce inside the 10-yard line.
How about that? Mark D'Antonio told us he was going to talk to Jim Tressel Friday night. Says he talks to him normally on Fridays. Has great respect for him. Says he's a big game coach. He knows how to win the big games. Coach Tressel won a big one this afternoon. And his former defensive coordinator is going to win a huge one tonight.
Big day and night for Ohio teams. Ohio State wins the big matchup with Michigan. Cincinnati, the stunning upset of Rutgers. This is the highest ranked opponent Cincinnati has ever beaten. Back in 1999, it was number 9 Wisconsin. Tonight, it is number 7 Rutgers. They will deny the Scarlet Knights a shot at a national championship, and the crowd here ready to storm the field when this one is over 20 seconds from now.
They need to let Rutgers get to the other end of the field.
They better hurry. Arguably the biggest win in the history of Cincinnati football. Certainly the biggest under Mark D'Antonio, and a very disappointing night for Greg Schiano and the Scarlet Knights of Rutgers. But it wasn't a game where a bad call or a bad break decided it. They were outplayed and beaten by a Cincinnati team that was the better team tonight.
They were the better team on both sides of the ball. They put a disappointing loss behind them a week ago in Morgantown. And on senior night, had their biggest win of the season.
Score here in Cincinnati, the Bearcats 30, the Rutgers Scarlet Knights 11. Sports Center is coming up next. Over on ESPN News, it's Post Game Extra. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide worldwide leader in sports. For Todd Blackledge, Holly Rowe, and our entire ESPN crew, this is Mike Patrick. Thanks for watching, and good night from Cincinnati.